This month's Where Did the Road Go is brought to you by six amazing people. Allison Cook, Super Inframan, Bart Ooms, Billuminati, 36 Dingo, and Michael Fritzky. If you want to become a patron, www.wheredidtheroadgo.com. And now our show.
Transmission start. Welcome to Where Did the Road Go? Join us as we wander off the path and explore lost history, consciousness, the paranormal, unexplained mysteries, alternative thought, and much more. We are present on the web at wheredidtheroadgo.com. Now here is your host, Seriah.
Welcome to this edition of Where Did the Road Go? I have with me Mr. A.P. Strange.
Hello, hello.
And Christopher Ernst.
Hey, everybody.
And before we get into the subject of tonight's show, earlier today, like about 2 hours ago, Super Inframan was here. Unfortunately, he couldn't stay for this, but we went out and checked out a very creepy graveyard outside of Ithaca, and we did a video on it, and that will be up later. But the one thing that happened that is not on video, of course, I had turned the camera off and started just taking some pictures, and there was a loud thunk right next to me, as if someone threw a stone. And I just kind of stopped and I looked and I'm like, I don't see anything that could have made that loud of a thunk. And I didn't realize that Natalie had also heard it standing quite a distance away. And she thought it was something I did. Yeah. But of course, that thunk is not on video. There's no audio of it because, you know, we had just filmed for 30 minutes. And that's how that stuff works.
Of course.
So that'll be up if it's not already. So it's definitely an interesting place. We're going to have to go back there. Maybe when you come out, Chris.
Yeah, this is a new one, too, that you were telling me about. Have you mentioned it before? Like, I know a lot of the stuff, the places you've taken me to, you've mentioned on the show, but this is a new place.
I mentioned it briefly. People have told me repeatedly that it's very haunted. The whole area is weird.
That's cool.
And when I had a doctor's appointment recently, the nurse found out I did a paranormal show and was telling me she used to live up there, and it was a really weird place.
Oh, nice.
And I'm like, yes, I need to get back up there, you know? Yeah. And, Saxon being here was a good opportunity to go up and check it out.
Cool. I love it.
The first time I went up was right at the beginning of the pandemic. So it's when stores were still closing at like 6 p.m.
Yeah.
And I come out of the store and I'm like, maybe I should try and find this place. So I did. And I got there just at dusk because you can drive right by it like numerous times and not know it's there. And it was creepy as all hell. And so I wanted to go back there with someone and see if I got the same impression. And it's not necessarily a bad vibe. It's just, it's weird. Like there's no sound.
Yeah.
There's no birds. There's no insects. There's no nothing. And you're in the middle of a woods. So you'll see on the video. But yeah, the thunk was just kind of like, what? You know, like why? Why couldn't that have happened while the camera was still going?
Yeah. Ain't that the way it always goes?
Yeah, because then I could listen back and be like, okay, did that really sound like a rock? You know, could that have been something else? But it was loud, whatever it was. All right, so tonight we're going to be talking about theosophy, because I've never done a show on theosophy, and both of you know a little bit about theosophy.
Yeah, yeah. And you just read, what was the book that you just recently read, AP?
Oh, I was reading The Secret Doctrine.
You were reading The Secret Doctrine itself. Okay, I forgot it was Isis Unveiled or The Secret Doctrine. Yeah, cool.
So many, many years ago, I borrowed those from the library and I could not get through either one.
Yeah.
Like they were just, like they did not catch me at all. I read the first few chapters and of course they're enormous books.
Yeah.
And I was just like, I'm not interested in this.
It's a common experience, I think.
Yeah, they're not exactly the most fun reading. Neither are the Mahatma letters, the ones that are, you know, ostensibly these letters between some of the Mahatmas that they speak about in Theosophy. Yeah, it's I've read those. The one that you were just speaking about, AP, I have not read. What is it? What's it called? Theosophy, questions about theosophy or something like that.
The Key to Theosophy.
The Key to Theosophy. Yeah. Yeah.
Which is actually, the other ones. That would be ideal for a beginner, I think.
Yeah. 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 The other stuff is the other stuff that is really, I wouldn't know where to start to, you know, whenever anybody asks about this, I tell them to read Gary Luckman's book rather than actually read the source material first.
All right. Well, where does Theosophy come from?
Well, it comes from Madame Blavatsky.
Okay.
And I mean, this is kind of the impetus for this in a lot of ways to me was just that for the reason I was looking into it is because Theosophy is such a wide and broad subject with a lot of dense esotericism. It's kind of done that way on purpose, but yeah. We're also a very long tradition. So we're talking over 100 years. Almost 150 at this point, you know, that a lot gets conflated and rolled together as one thing. But when you're talking about the origins of it, it begins with Madame Blavatsky and Henry Steel Olcott in America. So it's an American thing too, you know.
Yep.
And that goes back to the founding of the society in 1875.
Right. And then from there, like a lot of, you know, new religious movements and religious in general, there are, I would say, like, you know, two or three waves after that where you get these people who essentially take over leadership and, you know, oftentimes reinterpret dogma and, you know, add things, take things away, so on and so forth. And so Theosophy, in many ways, for many people, it is, you know, more something that has to do with like the I Am movement, or, you know, Guy Ballard, or, you know, stuff that was happening more in like the, you know, first part of the 20th century, rather than in the latter part of the 1800s. I don't know if you'd agree on that, AP, but that's kind of how I
see it. Yeah, I would. And I think it really speaks to how influential Blavatsky and Theosophical concepts actually are.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there are some, it's fitting that we're recording this on Mother's Day because there are some that would refer to her as the mother of the modern occult.
Right. And that's, you know, I think that's a pretty accurate statement too. Yeah.
Yeah, it is. But I mean, the reach of Theosophy in the popular mindset is touch on popular culture ufology with the contactees. There was a lot of contactee stuff that's either adjacent to or directly derived from Theosophy. Yep. And in conspiracy theory, Theosophy looms large.
Well, didn't the Nazis take parts of Theosophy as well, with the root races and stuff like that?
Right. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's where it gets all tied up in conspiracy thinking.
Ah, okay.
Yep. But a lot of that too, a lot of that idea of root races and race in general, you know, had a lot to do with, you know, and this is not an excuse for it, but there was a lot of like anthropological and colonial sort of discovery going on at the time that Blavatsky was, you know, writing this stuff that was very, very culturally influential. And it's the same thing of like, I don't know, trying to think of something that's analogous. It's like, I don't know, in all the New Age stuff now, people are talking about quantum, you know, in the same way that I think in the mid 1800s, with a lot of the colonialism that was going on, there was this sort of like, you know, a colonialist anthropology that was trying to use the scientific method or science to create some sort of, you know, post-Darwinian idea of classification of evolution and, you know, human beings and stuff like that. I guess in a loose way. And so I feel like there's a lot of that influence too in her adopting this idea of the root race, you know, and as problematic as it is, I don't know if it was something that came out of her mind, you know, whole cloth as much as it was influenced by things that were going on culturally.
Now, did she she claimed to sort of channel this stuff, didn't she? Was that part of it?
Well, yeah, well, not exactly. That's where you get into the masters and the Mahatmas.
Yeah.
Okay.
But before we move on entirely from the root race concept, there's layers to that. Everything Blavatsky writes about has like a Russian doll kind of aspect to it, where take it apart. There's a story within a story within a story. Because there is the esoteric end of what she meant by race in that sense. Because she's borrowing from you know, kind of old Hinduist Hindu ideas and ideas out of Eastern religion.
Yeah.
But not verbatim. She's not.
No, exactly.
She's not representing it, and nor does she claim to. She's not exactly claiming to represent the Eastern beliefs the way that they're practiced all the time. But the root race idea comes from the idea that we're talking about massive timescales here. There's different ages or epochs, as Rudolph Steiner would later call them, of the development of what became humanity.
Yeah.
So as far as she was concerned, we're in the fifth root race, of which there's seven sub-races. We're in the fifth one of those.
Yeah, I feel like all that taxonomy is so indicative of the time, you know what I mean?
Well,
that
what she's referring to by race is like the material physical being.
Yes.
So she's saying that in the first root race, there was no material form at all. It's like you're just like an energy being, right? Yep. And then it moves on from there, the second root race. The third was supposed to be the ancient Lemurians.
Yeah.
The fourth was the Atlanteans.
Yeah.
And the current root race, and this is where it gets problematic in the extreme from a modern lens, is that it was the Aryans, the fifth root race, which it represents all of people we are now. And when she talks about race as we would think of the term now, I mean, you know, it's debatable. There are different ways of looking at it, but the main thrust of and the stated goals of the Theosophical Society was a universal brotherhood of all races, creeds, religions, and there's a unifying principle there.
Yeah.
So, not to say there isn't problematic stuff.
Oh, no. She said some really crappy stuff, you know, some terrible stuff about like physical races, about African Aborigines in Australia, and stuff like that. She said some pretty bad stuff, you know, referring to them as like animals or half animals and things like that. And I think, I think a lot of this stuff is, you know, in many ways, how that sort of colonialist anthropology was approaching things at that time.
Mm, right.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's all very complicated.
But, yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, that like you said, there is a lot of that in the popular mindset in science. I mean, we're talking about an era where phrenology was being explored,
right?
And ideas of diffusionism, that there was one society that spread out, and you know, there are some that are more pure than others, that kind of thing. A lot of ideas that were supportive of a colonial mindset, there was the European was the ideal of society, and it was, you know, the divine right that they take ownership of all other places on earth.
And at the same time, she was very anti-oppression too. That was a big thing that she was fighting against. And the later, you know, sort of involvement of Theosophy in the Indian independence movement, you know, was certainly a positive thing. So there's a lot of like, you know, there's a lot of contradiction and, you know, a sort of cognitive dissonance that's going on here. Or it's somebody that's, you know, that is, I guess, changing their mind or having evolving thoughts and opinions. But yeah,
Political stuff within the society, because so you're talking about a woman from Russia, or modern Ukraine, but that's where she was born. But she was a Russian woman living abroad, doing what she wanted. Which, I mean, although she came from nobility and had that kind of privilege, I mean, she was a woman doing whatever she wanted in the 1850s, 60s.
Yeah. And it was in the 50s that she, you know, just to sort of fill in for people that aren't, you know, familiar, it was in the 50s that she, you know, through this privilege, ostensibly traveled around and was in different parts of Asia and Europe and the, you know, and during that time, she said that she was, you know, that she met these spiritual, these adepts, and these weren't, you know, described as gods when in the way that she describes them first meeting them. They were these sort of masters of, you know, she calls them masters of ancient wisdom, but they were sort of these spiritual adepts. And that was where she ended up going to Tibet for her quote unquote training, whether or not this actually happened. But that was, you know, the story that she told.
And let's be clear, we're talking about the
1850s. 1850s, yes, correct.
Yeah, and she made her way to America too.
Yep,
And went straight across the country to San Francisco before departing and heading back to Asia, I think.
So,
it's all pretty crazy to think that she was doing that at that time. And a lot of this time she was, you know, she came from with wealth, but she could do without as well. You know, she could rough it.
Yeah.
I think at one point in her travels, she even fought in a battle somewhere. She just joined up with a battle that was going on.
Yes.
Really?
Yeah. She had injuries from it for the rest of her life. She would show people like bullet wounds that she got, or maybe just sword scars. I'm not sure. But yeah, the point I was getting to is, so when she founded the Theosophical Society in 1875 with Henry Olcott, this was in the United States, and pretty quickly left to go to India. Like the British people that were all about theosophy, this is where you had the first kind of major cognitive dissonance within the leadership, because I believe that the British people that had a vested interest in colonizing, keeping the colonies of the colonized India a thing, were interpreting it very differently than Blavatsky would.
Yeah.
And certainly the way Olcott would, being an American. So, I mean, Blavatsky being a Russian, she was actually being shadowed and followed around because a lot of the British people thought she was a spy for Russia and trying to poison the minds of the Indians against the British so that the Russians could actually colonize India. So,
interesting.
Yeah.
So everything she wrote was information she picked up from these masters when she was out in Tibet stuff.
Well, that and her own studies.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So
she was traveling, like doing all this traveling sort of, and she was part of the spiritualist movement, you know, I'm trying to think, cause she traveled all around. She was in like Constantinople. She was in Egypt. There was this guy, I forget what's, I'm trying to remember what his name was. But there was like a Coptic magician she supposedly met. The mesmerists and stuff like that. It was in England that she met, somebody that she described as, Indian. And that was the person, who had appeared to her in her childhood visions. This was Moira, Master right. Moira. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And I mean, obviously a lot of people just throw out the word, fraud when they talk about Blavatsky.
Yeah.
And is that just because she was doing some trickstery things here and there, or?
Well, the people think that the adepts, because the stories of the adepts and who she referred to as the masters and later became known as the Mahatmas and various different interpretations beyond her death, they became what's known as ascended masters.
Yeah. And then Guy Ballard, you know, and there was all this stuff that happened after that that really took them into a, like, you know, contactee space, and there's, you know, even more linkage of the masters to, like, you know, established figures in history and stuff like that.
But yeah, I mean, the masters, the Mahatmas, whatever you want to call them, that's a big part of the reason people would consider Blavatsky a fraud.
Okay. I thought it was some of the seance stuff as well.
They didn't believe any of that. No, I mean, people were more primed to believe in seances than they were
okay. All right.
Mystical adepts from
the Orient. So here's the thing. And, you know, I mean, whether or not it's true, what she's talking about is based upon some very real stuff that exists. Like, if people are familiar with Sufism, and I know that you're friends with Professor Wham, maybe this is something that, you know, she can talk about. I'm sure she knows better than I. You know, my exposure to Sufism is through this a very sort of strange, offshoot of that, which is the Meher Baba movement. But within Sufi mystic tradition, there are these, essentially they're saints is what they are, called Abdals. And, you know, there are ranks of these sort of 40 saints in a larger group of 356 saints. And they all, you know, essentially are filling these roles exactly the way people are attributing to ascended masters or, you know, Mahatmas. And in the Indian tradition, too, in the, you know, Advaitic tradition, which is an offshoot of Hinduism, you know, the idea of the avatar and of the, the saint, too, the holy man, the Sadguru, is very much, you know, like, I mean, I would be absolutely blown away if what Blavatsky was, talking about wasn't in some way influenced by this. And this is a similar thing too, that, you know, you hear Gurdjieff talk about. He talks about these, you know, Sufis sort of adepts that he met that are, you know, introduced him to this, you know, sort of secret knowledge. This isn't something which kind of came whole cloth out of nowhere. It was just that nobody really knew about it. And it's not necessarily secret. Like, it continued into, you know, today in India, there's still a tradition of this going on. You know, and they're referred to as perfect masters. And there's a whole sort of series of, you know, like the spiritual hierarchy that is where there are certain numbers of these masters and they have certain duties and stuff like that. So the belief thing aside, this is not something that, you know, is a weird, fraudulent imagination based story that somebody came up with. This is coming from, you know, cultures that are thousands of years old that already have the same narratives, these same mythologies.
Yeah.
And the stories about them are really fun.
Yeah.
I think there's a website that I can't remember what it is now, but they have copies of like Olcott's recollections and stuff of actually encountering them. And some of the stories read like encounters with Men in Black or Space Brothers.
Totally.
Same kind of stuff.
Yeah. And,
Gary Lachman makes a point of saying that in his book, and he's absolutely right. There's a story about like the masters showing up to visit Olcott and making it rain in his room.
Right.
Mm.
And even though the rain's falling and making everything wet, the masters themselves don't get wet.
Yeah.
And he runs out of the room and goes downstairs to where Blavatsky was sitting in the parlor, and she's sitting there smoking cigars with the masters that were just in his room a minute ago.
Yeah. I mean, you'll find stories like this all over India, you know, of these masters. And usually they live, you know, the difference, though, is that they don't live in secret. They just live as ascetics, you know, meaning that most of them live just sort of very humble lives. But you can find there are people from the like early part of the century that, you know, were ostensibly these folks like Narayan Maharaj and Tajuddin Baba. And these are both Muslim and Hindu. And you can find all of these, you know, weird stories about similar things happening with people, these miraculous things happening. But they're just thought of as saints is what they're essentially thought of within, you know, the culture in India.
Hmm. Okay. That's interesting. I didn't know that.
Yeah. And so so like when I hear like, you know, my exposure to Theosophy and the things that, you know, I read about it is because it was, you know, it was something that happened probably about, I don't know, I mean, the Meher Baba stuff that I was raised with, that started in like, the, you know, 1915, 1920. So it's, you know, 40, 50 years earlier than that. But it's a very similar sort of track. And there was a lot of overlap between some of the people that were in working and doing Theosophy work in India in the early part of the 20th century and some of the Meher Baba folks. But I only bring this up because it's, you know, from a very recent sort of, you know, mystical teacher being Meher Baba, he was speaking about essentially the same thing, but tracing it to these very long, you know, these legacy ideas that come from Zoroastrianism and Sufism and Hinduism. But he was essentially saying the same thing that Blavatsky was, in that, you know, there is, you know, the fundamentals that are expounded in the Secret Doctrine being like there is this eternal immutable reality and that spirit and matter are both aspects of that, and there's, you know, these cycles of evolution that, you know, grand cycles that we go through, cyclical change. You're talking about yugas in that way. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, all
like 340 billion years or something. Right.
And that all souls are identical under this sort of oversoul of our para-atma, you know, that's completely Adivedanta. That's, you know, thousands of years old. That's the atma and the para-atma, the idea of the oversoul. And so all of these teachings of Blavatsky are, you know, they're not new. It's just nobody outside of India or the Middle East had heard of them at that point.
Okay. All right.
Well, yeah, that's the crux of it, is it's the difference between like Eastern esotericism and Western. And it's trying to bring the East into the West and kind of reconcile the two in a way. But speaking of like fraud, that's one of the other things. The Secret Doctrine itself, by all accounts, seems to be a literary invention of Madame Blavatsky's.
Exactly.
Which is the stanzas of Jian, which is that's the text that the masters gave to her and helped her to decipher from its original language, which I think she said was Zenzar, is like a pre-science.
Yeah. And this is all very much not Vedantic. This is all Buddhist. Like now she's switched into this sort of cribbing from Tibetan Buddhism.
Right.
Yeah.
But the stanzas of Jian were her own literary invention.
Yes. Right. So, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's why a lot of people, that's another reason people would claim fraud.
Yeah.
Now, did she admit that or did that just not
happen? No, she never admitted that. No.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's, you know, I mean, like I think you said very blatantly in us talking about this pre-notes and who you were quote, I forget if you were quoting somebody, but that, you know, she's essentially trying to create a, you know, a new mythology. And she in her like amalgamation and this sort of synthesis of all these ideas that she came across, and whether or not, you know, I personally, at least in my experiences, I do think that there are, it's not secret, but I do think that there are within particular yogic and tantric practices, there is this sort of like, you know, there is this linkage to hermeticism and this sort of way of looking at the world in a mystical sense that does go back pretty far, and that you see it, you know, kind of like pop up in different ways in these different sort of occult or esoteric spaces throughout history. At least in my experience, it seems that way. So I think that, you know, Blavatsky in her sort of taking of all of these different things, I feel like she was almost, you know, perhaps, and again, I could be wrong, she was trying to like re-enchant or, I don't know, I guess, like you said, AP reconcile maybe. But I don't know if her in the way that somebody thinks about something being fraudulent, you know, in order to make money, I mean, I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, but there's something about it that seems like there was a certain level of inspiration, that caused her to feel like she, you know, was doing something, you know, positive. Mm.
So you said that she basically made up the Secret Doctrine, but is everything in there made up of the Eastern beliefs that were already existent, or did she come up with other stuff?
Well, besides, I'm sorry, go ahead, AP.
Oh, I was gonna. My point with the stanzas of Jian was that she invented this base text that all traditions have sprung from. So there's one source where all traditions have some kind of hidden thread that ties back to that somehow.
Yeah.
So when people talk about her plagiarizing or stealing from different traditions, what she's essentially doing is world building based on this idea that there was like one sacred text originally that explained everything. Right. And it's a mythical text that it's a literary invention of hers, but the ends justified the means as far as she was concerned with that.
But besides that, everything except for the root races I have encountered in, you know, longstanding Hindu, you know, Adivedantic and Sufi tradition and Zoroastrian tradition. The root race stuff I haven't come across, but a lot of the other stuff, you know, the ideas of the seven planes of existence, you know, and the monad, and a lot of this. I mean, most of the stuff is cribbed from different Eastern spiritual and mystical traditions.
Yeah, and she does touch on like Kabbalah.
Yep.
That kind of bridges the gap to the Western traditions a little bit, you know. But she seems to be antagonistic towards Western theology.
Yeah.
And in a lot of ways, like she's very critical of the Christian ideologies.
Yeah.
I mean, to the point where she named her newsletter Lucifer, I think.
Yeah.
And there's a story that Lachman writes about that, like at her baptism, I guess the priest accidentally set himself on fire.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So, I mean, she was kind of antagonistic towards Western beliefs too, which is kind of cool, but she's also saying that stuff also, it had a longer journey from the original source. So it's like a much more mutated version of that sacred stuff, the secret doctrine, but it still has a tie to all the other traditions. Yeah. But I mean, it goes to show that even if she did make it up, you're talking about, like, I read the cosmogenesis part of the secret doctrine, which was about 700 pages, and she cites her sources the whole way around. Like she did her studies, like she knew what she was.
Yeah.
Like she just made it all up. She had to have studied a lot to be able to accurately depict any of this on any level. So,
okay, that's interesting. So did she invent the root race idea, or is that also found elsewhere but Christians didn't come across it?
Yeah, I mean, what she's talking about there with, like, the various Manvantaras, I thought
yeah,
that kind of came out of Vedantic tradition.
Yeah, I mean, to some degree, like, the way in which
Tibetan stuff with the Dhamma.
Yeah, no, I mean, you're right in that there are these, and there's, you know, quite a bit of criticism that is arguing for, you know, the misinterpretation of this from, you know, Sanskrit and from the Vedas and stuff like that. But the idea of the caste system, and that in terms of, I guess, there being these different, like, you know, you have your Brahmin, and then which is sort of like the higher class. But the thing about the caste system is that the caste system was, you know, it's a socio-political construct that was based upon, you know, an interpretation of religious texts in the same way that, you know, the Catholic Church does it. But it's, you know, the idea of those fixed social groups and the sort of social stratification, it does exist, and it did became a big part of the caste system in India, but it didn't exist so much in the way in its association with the yugas. Like, the yuga cycle is different in that there are, like, different age. It's more like the Greek idea of the different ages. You know, you have the golden age, and then you have sort of a lesser golden age, and right now we're in the Kali Yuga, which is the sort of the iron age, and it's the most sort of physical base worst age, and then, you know, we cycle back to the other ages. But the things that
people say we're living in the worst timeline,
that's, yeah,
also, right, Blavatsky was saying.
Yeah, but the ideas of, like, the Varna, Jati, and caste, which are the things that that I think you're talking about, those are these, like, frameworks for grouping people in Vedic Indian society. And at least in my, you know, I'm sure that there are some people who are, you know, fundamentalist Hindus that don't believe this, but it very much seems like a corruption of much more esoteric ideas of sort of different phases of evolution. And this was taken, you know, and turned into a socio-political system, as most things are, for control.
The evolutionary and involutionary things are taking place on a crazy big time scale.
Exactly.
The Theosophical tradition. So,
yeah,
I mean, one Manvantara is like 340 billion years long.
Mm. Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
we have like 427,000 years before this cycle is over or something.
According to them. Yeah. There are others that say that we're, you know, we're coming out of it right now. We're heading out of the Kali Yuga into, you know, the Dvapara Yuga, I think. Is that what it is?
I think so.
Trying to remember off the top of my head. Yeah.
The age of Aquarius, that ties into a lot.
Right.
Too. Right.
Right.
Well,
right.
That's the yuga cycle that more closely matches the Greek golden age cycle.
Correct.
Which is, yeah, also very keyed into the precession of the equinoxes.
Right, right. Right.
But according to the Theosophical evolutionary involutionary thing, is that you start off as something more ethereal. When you do come into matter, you start off as a mineral, work your way up to a plant.
And, yeah,
incarnation cycles, and then you become an animal and then a human being, and then from there you have a couple of steps that are more spiritual before you join the Oversoul.
So that's the way that Meher Baba, as a, you know, 20th century mystic that's drawing from Sufi and Vedic tradition, the way that he parsed it was that, yes, that's exactly it. So that, you know, in sort of the timeless time before time, you know, there was the infinite intelligence, and that, you know, when the infinite intelligence split, and there is this idea of splitting into seven, that this number seven does have some sort of harmonic significance, not that it split into seven rays, but they're, you know, for sort of looking at a model of conceptualization, that there was this sort of split into seven. And that from there, there's this, like, you know, further separating from, you know, the Paramatma, the Oversoul, and that the what happens, you are starting essentially as energy, as consciousness, let's say, and that this consciousness is separated. Some of these consciousnesses descend completely to the physical level and start as an atom, and then will, you know, evolve. And it's essentially a chrysalis, you know, process for the infinite intelligence that is all of creation to know itself. So humans, you know, up to human, from Adam, you know, through, like, you know, Adam state, you know, bacteria, fish, you know, birds, animals, humans. And that from when you reach human, you actually go, and there's this involution that happens. And the human form is very loosely described. So it could be humanoid. It doesn't necessarily have to be human as we see it. But then there's this involutionary process where essentially you involve and you start to experience through your other sense organs the different planes of existence, the seven planes of existence that are also talked about in Theosophy. And that at some point, you know, you reach, again, this sort of understanding of the Oversoul and your individual soul that has sort of accumulated all of these things through reincarnation. And that it's really just like a process of consciousness evolving. Then that's really what it is. It's part of like a natural, almost.
Consciousness experiencing all levels of materiality and non-reality. Right. So you can envision it like a bell curve.
Yeah.
Like you start off with one end being immaterial and just pure energy and move towards a material hardened form.
Yeah.
And then while maintaining that same kind of consciousness.
Yeah.
And then kind of moving back toward the immaterial again.
Right. Exactly. Know? Yeah. And that this is just a constant process that we are a part of, that is, you know, the matter of the universe and all of creation. So, yeah, and that then that's that stance in Theosophy is not only one that, you know, does show up very specifically what we were talking about is a, you know, comes from Adivedanta. And so it's, you know, when she talks about that, when Blavatsky's talking about that, it's not something that is, you know, at least for me, when I came across it, it wasn't a new idea. It's something that I had come across before.
Okay. So, I mean, it's pretty obvious how people like Aleister Crowley influenced the modern occult movement. What influences did Blavatsky's work have on it?
Well, Blavatsky influenced Crowley.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's true. Yeah.
He was around first. Yeah.
But, I mean, she was the reason for sort of like the modern revival of Western esotericism. I think, you know, if you read Lachman's book on her, he's basically saying that like all modern occult and esotericism can trace it back to her influence. So she was really crucial, because if you think about it, like these ideas of that come from Sufism and Buddhism and Hinduism, they all, these Eastern sort of traditions, think about how influential they are and how all pervasive they are on kind of like New Age occultism nowadays, and the paranormal even, and how we think about the paranormal. And if, you know, it really, like, if you look at it, it's very, very, you know, interesting to see how many of these terms, like, you know, have become part of our popular culture. Like even the term avatar is a Hindu term that is very specifically having to do with this idea of a physical incarnation of the, the supreme God in the sense of, Hinduism. But if you want to think about it in terms of like something a little less, old white man beard in the sky, that, these avatars are essentially physical incarnations of spiritual or consciousness entities, sorry, I lost my train of thought.
That's okay. You're talking about how these terms pop up.
Yeah, how these terms pop up. And so, I think that without her bringing this in, we would be looking at a very different sort of landscape of esotericism and the occult.
Because she was always a controversial figure, but she was very, the theosophical ideas were very popular. Like the societies were huge not too long after she started them. Which means that a lot of these Eastern ideas were being fed into Western, Western societies, like in the Americas, even at a time when it was all brand new to a lot of them.
And so
I mean, that's kind of it's not to say nobody had gone to India or Tibet before and learned about some of this stuff, but there were scholarly works on it, right? They themselves were often flawed interpretations of it. So I mean, a lot of these ideas that have made their way into occultism, wouldn't have, at least not in the same way, if it hadn't been for Theosophy.
I mean, think about how much the sort of this idea of the ascended masters and the way in which it sort of, at least in the later days of Theosophy, played out. And I'm not talking about Blavatsky, but the later days of Theosophy, that to me seems to, like, you can see that going directly into the contactee movement,
After she had died, like C.W. Ledbetter and Annie Besant running the show, I mean, Ledbetter's responsible for a lot of like really bad new age stuff.
Oh yeah. he was a terrible pedophile too,
And I mean, new agey ideas about chakras were published by him, are bad renderings of Eastern thought.
And he was the guy that, with Besant, they were the ones that found Krishna Murti and sort of, put him forth, as if people aren't familiar with this, they essentially found this, young boy in India. Ledbetter, of course, was the one who did it in this very sort of creepy way when you read him describing, sort of seeing Krishnamurti. I've heard that since that Krishnamurti did, they're from some of the, people that I've talked to, whether or not they actually know anything, I don't know, but I believe them, that Krishnamurti did, did have some sort of mystical or spiritual gifts, but he ended up deciding, after he had been chosen and groomed to be this avatar, that he was like, no, I'm not. He's like, I have some ideas for how to live a spiritual life, and he did teach spirituality, but he sort of tried to distance himself from Theosophy the older he became.
To be like the coming master.
Yes, the coming master, right? Which is this idea that, keeps on coming up, the Maitreya.
Where did Maitreya come from?
That's a Buddhist idea.
Okay, right.
But a lot of this also has to do with the idea, the Hindu idea, or overlaps with the Hindu idea of the avatar, because the avatar is cyclical, keeps on coming. So, there are, and for me at least, I think it makes the most sense if you were to sort of start believing in these types of cycles, that, you get people like Jesus or Buddha or Zoroaster, or Muhammad, or, St. Francis of Assisi, or, pick any others, maybe even more recently, somebody like Gurdjieff, or possibly Meher Baba, or, I don't know about Blavatsky, but, there's certain other people that are these, that are sort of these teachers, or they get, I would even say Jane Roberts, maybe Cayce or something. These, you're getting some tapping in, some like genuine, like humans that do have some sort of, that are tapped into something, whether or not it is a formal spiritual hierarchy or control system, of ascended masters, maybe that's one way to look at it. You know, but you could also look at it as in, you know, there are some people that might evolutionarily or involutionarily, I don't know, I just invented two words, that they're, you know, that they're going to have some, you know, developing cities or, you know, having psychic powers or understanding or being tapped into the, you know, Akashic field. Or I'm just throwing tons of, you know, terms out here, but I think that I at least am very open to that possibility. And so I think that, you know, you get these ideas of like the Avatar or the Ascended Master or something like that. I think there could be a very, you know, real basis for this that isn't something, you know, as like woo-woo or I don't know, even like anthropomorphically problematic as what the Ascended Masters became in Theosophy.
Right, which kind of gets to the concept of bodhisattvas.
Exactly, yes, yeah.
Which is,
I don't know if you want to talk about that.
Well, I mean, the idea that you like having passed on instead of attaining nirvana, even though they could, they just kind of hang around and help out.
Yep. Oh, I see.
Ethereal beings.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's referred to as like the secret chiefs.
Yep.
Kind of idea, and occultism kind of comes from that.
Yep.
Secret chiefs of the third order, I think,
is what they're
called in the OTO. But like Ascended Masters is more like that, where they're just kind of like an outside force that was once human and has kind of now become an ethereal,
I mean, if I'm doing, you know, complete speculation, which I like to do all the time, I think that you can think of it less like, you know, with human motivations and more like the way that, you know, certain, I don't know, animals or plants or different, you know, things interact with an ecological system, you know, like how bees are able to support certain types of life, you know, life
in our, that idea.
In our ecology, you know. I almost wonder is that if you achieve this sort of bodhisattva, you know, a state that, you know, maybe there's, you know, you stop thinking the way that humans do, and there's a different way that you sort of approach life. This is why it was interesting when Vuk was talking about his sort of Gaia theory stuff that you had on recently. And I had been sort of texting with him back and forth. You know, he had been talking about, you know, this in terms of Gaia theory. And I think that's definitely a way to look at it, you know, which that can be, you know, informative and interesting and possibly accurate in some way.
So it's almost a Taoist perspective.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So have we brought up the Great White Brotherhood yet? I don't think we've talked about this.
Yeah.
So who wants to explain that?
That's just meant to mean like the forces of good versus the forces of darkness.
That's what I figured.
It's the simplest way of putting it.
Yeah, it's like Black Lodge, White Lodge, which, you know. Yeah.
Which is where Twin Peaks kind of took it from, right?
Oh, absolutely. So, yeah.
100%, yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's a lot of theosophical stuff going on.
That's, so you're getting like that from both. Lynch is bringing the Vedantic stuff into it, you know, because he's heavily involved in TM, Transcendental Meditation, which, you know, as an organization and the leader of it, you know, I personally think is kind of problematic, but the stuff that they're talking about as, you know, very real roots in things that at least I've experienced to be sort of pretty valid. But the great, and then God, who is it? Mark Frost. He also is a huge sort of occult Western esotericism historian. So he injected a lot of theosophical kind of, you know, like plot points and Easter eggs and stuff like that and themes into Twin Peaks. But yeah, the Great White Brotherhood versus the sort of, it's this idea. And this is one that, I don't know. I mean, there are a lot of people that still sort of, you know, are kind of convinced this is going on. There was the last Strange Realities, I think it was Olav Phillips did his presentation kind of on this idea of the Black Lodge. And you know, he seems to think that there is proof for there being these, you know, there being opposing forces of sort of like, learned, adept, dark, you know, mystics versus light mystics, I guess, in the sense of positive versus negative. But yeah. I don't know. I haven't, you know, I've never, none of the people that I've talked, none of the sort of, you know, mystics that I've talked to or the stuff that I've read from my little corner of the world has seen to be anything like that, but who knows?
Yeah, I mean, it kind of goes into the mythology of it too, with the Atlantis, like the downfall of Atlantis was supposed to be the dark sorcerers that had,
Does she talk about that?
She does, yeah.
She does talk about Atlantis,
Lemuria and Atlantis.
I knew she talked about Lemuria. I didn't know if she talked about Atlantis.
Right, the third race was supposed to be from Lemuria, and the fourth was from Atlantis.
Okay,
Yeah.
Right. And again, you know, I mean, we all know now that Lemuria, that name at least itself, was, you know, based upon a guy talking about lemurs.
Yes.
You know, it's like not... It's not the ancient plateau of Lang, as you know some might think it to be,
and it appeared in Edward Bulwer Lytton's book prior to Blavatsky referencing it, I think.
Oh, okay.
Right,
The Vril, the coming race.
Right, Vril, the coming race, and that's another. I mean, I guess that's another like point we could talk about, because she does. You know, that is something that emerged from this, is this idea of Vril, but at least I've always thought of that as being, you know, that was a book that was written, Vril, the Coming Race, and it was a very, it was like fictional book about essentially like an underground race, kind of in the
Earth type stuff,
journey to the center of the earth type way, you know, and but out of that came this very real, like people adopted it kind of, you know, as truth. But they were using it to refurbish in this science fiction book, Vril, the Coming Race. They, you know, this advanced race from inside the earth, they use something called Vril as like, you know, secret electricity. It's like, you know, their zero point energy. But then it started to be adopted in this way that it was kind of standing in for the, you know, Eastern ideas of chi or ki or prana, which is, you know, something that has, you know, thousands of years of history to it, which is this idea of there being something that is connected to electricity that is like, you know, I don't want to say it's the way that at least I've heard it described to me is that electricity that we deal with for power is the shadow of the shadow of the shadow of like the real electricity. And that that is something that, you know, you could find more in like plasma forms or in, you know, lightning. And, you know,
pretty cool stuff.
It's cool stuff. Yeah. But it's that's what real, I mean, at least to me, in seeing historically now with 2020 vision, what Vril from that science fiction book became in terms of people believing in it, it almost was standing in for belief in something else, you know?
Right.
And is that a concept the Nazis also ran with?
I mean,
yeah,
I think so. Again, I feel like there's speculation as to whether or not the Nazis really went as deep into occultism as people say they did, or whether or not that's still like Morning of the Magicians.
You know? A lot of it comes from Powell's and Bergier writing about it in the 60s, and which may or may not have been, you know, I mean, it was absolutely sensationalized.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, and we can see from...
As a result, you get the sensationalized connections back to Theosophy, which there are connections there, but not as much as people would have you believe or assume just from a cursory glance at it.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. I think maybe people are just fascinated with the fact that the Nazis were looking at anything occult.
Well, I think they might have. They probably were. I mean,
oh no, they certainly were. But
yeah, in the same way that, like, you know, we see what they were also doing is they were just being completely unscrupulous in terms of their scientific in terms of their experiments.
Yeah,
you know, like, and that's Operation Paperclip right there. Like, you know, I think there's probably a lot of overlap in terms of this idea of them doing these horrible occult experiments with the very real, you know, just torture that they were doing in, you know, as part of the paperclip type experiments that,
And I mean, that comes from science, you know, I mean, that comes from the scientific end of it.
Yeah.
It's like people are quick to blame the occult end of things a lot of the time because I guess it's scarier and more fun.
Yeah.
You know, it becomes like that movie, the movie with Nazis on the moon and Hitler riding a dinosaur.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Right.
Iron Sky.
Yeah, it's the Iron Sky version of history, which people think is much more fun, especially when you're into fringe stuff.
But the terrifying
truth is that it was a bunch of scientists that wanted to prove that their bloodline was the right one, or that you could perfect man just by thinning out the herd. Like, eugenics wasn't an idea that came out of religious or esoteric thought. It was an idea that came out of logical scientific thought.
Right. Exactly. Yeah.
Hmm. So how did Blavatsky, I mean, we talked a little about the contactees, but what other influences did she have on the UFO field?
Well, a lot of the early contactees were, you know, directly theosophical. Adamski in particular. And when he wrote his first book with Desmond Leslie, Leslie was like very much a theosophist. Mm. There's a lot of overlap between contacteeism and theosophy in England. But the fact that that's the case, and where theosophy has its ties in with, as Chris had mentioned, the Ballards having influenced them, and William Dudley Pelley to some extent, and a lot of currents that tie into like conspiracy thinking, conspiracy theories over time have, theosophy is always something that pops up. It's always something that gets referenced here and there, right?
Yeah. Okay.
So it becomes part of that whole ball of wax that makes up the nebulous fringe thought, and it's always just kind of right there, you know. Gotcha. I think if you're a nuts and bolts ufologist, you probably aren't you wouldn't be aware of where some of that comes from, but and you probably wouldn't be encountering it as often. But when you're talking about the broad scheme of things with ufology, theosophy definitely played a role.
Yeah, and this whole idea of, you know, the overlap that you get of the Atlantis myth with UFOs. I mean, the Atlantis yep. myth as it exists now, and, you know, maybe the whole, like, ancient aliens, aside from sort of the tack that, like, von Däniken takes, you know, a lot of that is, you know, that revision of Atlantis, while I think, you know, arguably maybe Edgar Cayce had some influence on it, it's still coming from, you know, Blavatsky to some degree.
Huh. Okay. Let's take a quick break and we'll be right back. All right. Quick mid-show break. I'm basically a recommendation and a just some contact info. Of course, wheredidtheroadgo.com has everything you need to get a hold of me in any way, shape, or form, including a little pop-up when you go to the page that does not go to a bot. It goes to me. So if I don't answer you right away, it's because I'm like asleep or busy or something like that. But I generally will answer people if you message me on there. And of course, if you want to become a patron, it's only $3 a month. It helps out immensely. And you get extra content all month long. All right. For a recommendation, I'm going to go with a book called Healer. This is from F. Paul Wilson. It came out in 1977. Now, if I'm not mistaken, it's part of a series, but I never read the rest of the series. I didn't know it was part of a series, so I just started reading it one day, and it's awesome. I can't really remember a lot of the details other than I was just really blown away with what a good book it was. I'll read the back. The Federation of Man is being driven insane. A plague of psionic terrorism threatens humanity. Impossible holes open in midair, vomiting alien berserkers. An epidemic madness called the Horrors leave millions mindless gibbering cringing. Once again, the Healer emerges, a cosmically unique symbiote of man and alien being. Immortal, telepathic, scarred, and somehow human. He is the only galactic consciousness powerful enough to grapple with the alien evil called Kali. To mankind, he's a savior and a freak. This book was really, really good. It's not that long. It's only about 200 pages, and I assume it's easily available. Like I said, it came out in like 77. So if you like interesting sci-fi, that one's definitely high on my list. So that's my recommendation for this week. And now back to the show. So you're listening to Where Did the Road Go? And I have with me A.P. Strange and Christopher Ernst. And we're talking about Theosophy, Madame Blavatsky, and all things interconnected. When did Blavatsky die? And how did she die?
She died in the late 1800s.
Okay.
Yeah, 1892, I think.
Yeah. Do you know what she died of?
Well, she had a host of health issues. From a lot of hard living.
Actually,
it's funny because she died on May 8th, 1891. All right, so I was close. But we just passed like the anniversary of her death date.
Oh, okay. How old was she?
Stuck for me because I wanted to, one of my ideas for doing this was to just put her name into a search on social media just to see what pops up as comments when people do reference her. Because that's where you end up finding a lot of good misconceptions to unpack.
Right.
But there were, because it was Lotus Day, which is the celebration of her life on the anniversary of her death. So, so kind of synchronicity there. It kind of blew up my idea. But she had a lot of health issues.
She was 60, I think. She wasn't that old.
Yeah, but I mean, she
lived hard. She lived also hard. In the 1800s. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
She was never not smoking. She was huge on tobacco. So, and she was overweight, but she had like mobility issues. And I think she was kind of like in organ failure.
She was in a wheelchair towards the end of her life. I know.
Right. And she had massive organ failure while she was writing The Secret Doctrine, actually.
Oh.
And, you know, one of the stories was that one of the masters, Kut Humi, visited her and healed her basically so that she could finish writing the book. And I mean, like, I don't know how true it is, but it's kind of a nice story because it's like she's bedridden and the doctor comes and says she probably won't make it through the night. And then she claims that Kut Humi shows up and the woman that was kind of caring for her at the time comes in the next morning expecting to find her dead. And she's up in her wheelchair, like, where's my cigarettes? Where's my coffee? Come on, we got some writing to do. I mean, she had a number of things going on. I think there was various organs were just kind of barely functional at the end. So,
That sucks. So who took over? What happened with Theosophy after she passed away?
There was kind of a split as far as I know. This might have happened a little bit later. The split between Bailey and Besant. Because essentially there was Annie Besant, who I don't know when she might have been in the late 1800s that she had met and sort of became involved with Blavatsky. But it was towards the end there. And she had a particular way that she went with it that was, I think, along with Leadbeater. But then Alice Bailey was another woman who had, you know, been involved towards the end. And she had set up helped set up the Lucius Trust, which was like an extension of the Lucifer publishing imprint that Blavatsky had started. But I think that was the first split. Do you know AP?
Well, I mean, the thing about having anybody really in charge is that the society was founded in New York.
Yeah.
And then they pretty quickly established headquarters in London and India with the Adyar.
Right. And that's where Besant was mainly and Leadbeater were in India. Yeah.
Well, I mean, while Blavatsky was still alive, so she couldn't possibly be in three places at once. So there was already kind of a jockeying for who was going to control
Theosophy
during that time. And it was kind of in shambles when she was on her way out of this life.
Yeah,
because the people that were she left in charge in Adyar were plotting against her.
Right.
They were. That's when they had somebody from the Psychical Research Society in England come and investigate the claims of various like miraculous feats that Blavatsky had performed there.
Yeah.
And he was the one that released a huge report calling her a fraud for a lot of that. Lachman goes into a lot of detail in his biography about how much of that was based on hearsay and a lot of jiggery pokery on the part of the people that were left in charge of that building while Blavatsky wasn't there for like a year. And then in England you had AP Sinnott was running the London part of it, and he really kind of wanted to be in charge of a lot of that as well. So
what was the other name of the other guy? Was it Judge?
Yeah, William Quan Judge was in charge. And nobody talks about Judge. Like, they pretty much handed him the society in America and were like, see?
Right.
And he was like the least flamboyant theosophist. So I'd like to read some of his writings because I hear that they're...
I have not read any of his writings. No.
Yeah, it would be worth looking at, I guess, because he was less flamboyant, but maybe he had some cool things to say, but yeah, I mean, as far as once she died, you know, the schism that came to pass is what you're talking about.
Right.
But like Ledbetter wasn't popular among a lot of them.
No.
And the word got out about his, predilections with young boys.
Yep.
And he was kept around.
Yeah, they like he resigned, but didn't like leave. He was like, "I'm going to resign, but I'm still going to hang around."
Right.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, what year was this? Like roughly?
This was like
early 1900s.
I want to say that Besant sort of took over from Olcott. Yeah, it was like night. Or 1910, something like that.
Was there more tolerance for that type of thing back then?
I would say there was less, probably. Really? I mean, maybe it wasn't talked about openly enough. So
okay. Yeah, think it was. I think it was hidden, is what was happening. I mean, there was definitely like the thing that I know that happened with Leadbeater was that he was the thing that came out is that he'd been instructing boys to masturbate, which, you know, I mean, obviously that's sexual abuse there, but. He's
like that was the go-to as part of a spiritual practice.
Yeah, yeah. And that was the specific thing that sort of like, so the Theosophical Society did like, they raised formal they had a formal thing against him. Besant defended him, and that's when he sort of resigned, but yeah, it never really went away. I mean, I think it's the same thing that you see in a lot of these organizations where there's, you know, a lot of corruption and abuse of power. I mean,
yeah,
you know, it happens, you know, that I've found very few places and examples where that hasn't happened.
I guess I was asking because, you know, you had kids working in very dangerous jobs. You had people getting married at 12 years old and stuff like that in that time period. So I feel like that something like pedophilia might have been looked at differently. Of course, sex wasn't looked at as a positive thing at all. So,
I mean, I think pedophilia was looked at as, you know, bad, but you still, you know, there were child prostitutes, and it was one of those things that I think it was like, you know, a dirty part of society that, you know, on the public face was looked upon poorly, but, you know, bad things happened behind closed doors.
Yeah, and I mean, the part of what's weird about it too, or like incorporating it as part of their spiritual training, is that with Blavatsky, like the idea was to be entirely chaste.
Yeah,
and Blavatsky was one huge distinction between Theosophy and a lot of magical practices is that Blavatsky was like anti-sex to like the extreme, you know.
And she never married or anything, never had any children.
She was married two or three times, but she claimed that she never had sex.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So she claimed that she was never actually married because no marriage was ever consummated.
All right. So like, where is the Theosophy Society now?
You can still go to it. I mean, in New York, at least, I believe they still have an actual physical headquarters you can go to in a library.
Yeah, they have lodges and chapters all over the place. I mean, every major city has something, you know, I think. I know there's one in Boston, and then there's one in Springfield in Massachusetts, so I could go to either.
And I know that there's still a bunch in India. I didn't go to any when I was there, but I was, you know, I saw some, you know, outside of some.
Yeah, because I mean, it didn't go away, really.
No. Yeah.
And it's still around. I mean, out of curiosity, when I was reading The Secret Doctrine, I had like the little postcard thing fall out of it that it was self-addressed to the Theosophical College or Theosophy University or something like that. Yeah. The publishing house of all the Theosophical texts. Mm-hmm. And I was like, just for shits and giggles, maybe I'll put this in the mailbox and see if I get like a catalog back, you know, because that's what it's for. They'll send you a catalog. And they did. I did get like a Theosophy publishing house, but it was by hand manipulated where they were like crossing things out, like no longer available, or there were like correspondence courses that they were just like, this isn't a thing anymore, like handwritten in pen. And I'm like, oh man, rough times for the Theosophical Society.
Yeah, you would think they could just print out a new thing without all that stuff on it.
That's stacks and stacks of the old catalogs, just by hand, or putting stickers over things so that, you know.
So who runs it now? Is it run by different people in different places?
Yeah, I think that individual chapters probably just have their own groups doing it, you know.
Okay.
So. Yeah. I mean, there were some prominent people like for a while, like Thomas Edison, I know, was a theosophist.
Frank Baum was. I mean, and that's why, like, when you get into conspiracy stuff, sometimes I'll just hear somebody talking about, you know, a certain period of time, and they're like, oh, and then so-and-so was a theosophist. So, oh, you know. And to me, like, at certain points in history, calling somebody a theosophist is about the same as saying they had a library card. Because it's not like this really is like a religion or a cult or a high magical order. It was basically like a philosophical and esoteric book club where they could get together and talk about these things.
Yeah.
Like, you could join the Theosophical Society and not, it's not the same thing as like a secret society or a ritual magic setting, right? Yeah. It's more loose-knit than that in a lot of ways.
So I totally forgot. Oh, so what do you see when you look around as far as the biggest misconceptions about theosophy?
I think misconceptions happen as a result of conflating a lot of complicated things into a very small short-sighted view of it, which I think is true of just about anything.
Yes.
Sure.
But theosophy is so complicated. I think that the Ascended Master's idea has a long history that we spend a lot of time talking about, where people talk about the Mahatmas or the Masters themselves and don't really kind of get the stuff we talked about at the beginning of the show. I think gets misrepresented a lot. But I also think that there's a way of looking at Blavatsky and what she was doing that some of the fraud or perceived fraud or the plagiarism, quote unquote, or the cherry picking of ideas from or misrepresenting different traditions. That seems to be how it's always interpreted, but there was a goal to it, you know. Like, people will say that because she incorporated things that came from a science fiction story, she was somehow duped into thinking that was a real thing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But to her, it didn't really matter. I mean, I think she would go as far as to invent a text that doesn't exist as an explanation for why all these esoteric ideas appear across the world in different traditions, because they all stem from the same source, which was a text she made up. And it didn't matter that she was borrowing from fiction or fitting different esoteric ideas into her own cosmogony of how it all worked. Because ultimately, what she drives at constantly is the idea of the noumenon versus the phenomenon. And this gets to the concept in Eastern religions of Maya, the illusory version of reality that we're all familiar with. Anything that you can see or perceive at all on our very human level is an illusion built up around us. And this people conceive of this nowadays as the Matrix. Yeah. I mean, in ancient Greece, it was the shadows on the wall in the cave.
Right.
But it could be looked at as like Talbot holographic universe.
Yes.
Exactly. Yep. And this is what Blavatsky is saying, is none of this is real anyway.
Yeah.
Literally everything you can experience by definition is not real. But for all intents and purposes, it is. It's what we're stuck with. So you have to kind of navigate it. And what it means is more important. The noumena behind it is more important than what it physically is.
Right. I think the thing that gets misunderstood about the idea of Maya is that it's somehow like, you know, saying that, you know, this physical space that we're in and, you know, because it's illusion that somehow there's no worth to it. Or that it's something like the idea of escaping, you know, Maya. It has more to do with the idea that there is sort of greater realities that contain greater truth, but also, you know, I guess this idea that like nagging itch in the back of every person's mind of like, you know, not quite satisfied has to do with the fact that you're not getting the whole picture and that it's not that there's something wrong with it. It's just like in the same way that, you know, when you're a kid, you don't quite grasp something, you know, fully, or you're not able to fully, you know, appreciate something around you as your senses are growing. And that's, you know, that could be another way to look at it. So it doesn't necessarily have to be this thing of like, oh, it's all illusion. This is all, you know, garbage, like, you know, you do what you want or, you know, or it doesn't matter or something, anything like that. And that it's, you know, you have to think of it more as like a process that you're sort of like trying to push, you know, push through, and you're trying to essentially like move through. It is a process of becoming rather than a place that you are stuck.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, the simplest way I could think of it to explain it is nothing is real except all of it is.
Yes. Yes.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's the other thing, is that we're not separate. Like, we are in it right now. Like, the other world, you know, God, mystical, you know, everything. Like, we are literally, we are it, and we are in the middle of it. So it's not like something that, you know, is far, far away. That's a big thing too, that I think is a misconception.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. So the, that sound was a perfect exclamation point for what you said.
I think that was me hitting my, my springs.
Did you drop your mic? Is that what happened?
No,
that was a mic drop.
My mic drop. Yeah, that's right.
So you had sent us some notes here, AP. And yeah. One of the things about her personality, you said she was definitely a trickster using blinds to illuminate truth and humor, and not above using sleight of hand magic tricks.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And I mean, I think that gets to the heart of what I was saying, too, where like she kind of came to terms at the end of her life with being considered a fraud on some level. Mm-hmm. And she was only sad that like the masters got drugged through the mud and on account of her trickery and stuff.
Yeah.
But she didn't mind being considered a fraud so much as she seemed to mind the masters, the idea of the masters being considered false.
Right.
But you know what? Like, she was a very much a tricksterish figure. And if you read like The Occult World by A.P. Sinnett, that's the book where he's talking about the Mahatma letters, how he got them. Sinnett was like a journalist and a person in India, a British guy in India that worked with her and a huge proponent of Theosophy and eventually kind of like took over the London Lodge. But in his book, he's talking about Blavatsky's stay in India and how he cultivated a relationship with the masters through her. And a lot of what he's describing Blavatsky doing, the way he writes it, you're like, are you kidding me? That's a conjuring trick. Like,
yeah,
like, I know how that trick is done. Like making a cigarette disappear and then finding it on top of like the curtain rod in the other room. You know, it's like, oh, did she find a coin behind your ear too? Like,
and I think that's one of the things that people don't like about her sometimes, is that she does have that sort of like, there's all, you know, there's that like sideshow kind of like, I don't want to say huckster, but she has that spiritualist, you know, trickery, you know, aspect to her that is, you know, I think obviously part of the trickster that you find in, you know, a lot of these figures. And in fact, you find it in a lot of these figures that, you know, are, could be known as the ascended masters, or, you know, the Mahatmas or the adepts or whatever. There are, you know, plenty of stories and narratives and adages and things like that from Sufism and Hinduism that talk about these masters and things like that and their interactions with people being very much like the trickster. And I think that, you know, that was something that she embodied very well, but people don't understand it. It seems, you know, I think one of the biggest things that people are misunderstanding about her is they're writing off, well, yes, there are some incredibly racist things that developed out of Theosophy and things that she said herself. And, you know, there's no way that can be excused for that. But I think you also have to understand that it's not just a bunch of racist hogwash. There's some things that she's sort of drawing from and synthesizing that actually have a very real basis. And the way that she's looking at it is perhaps a way that is, you know, beneficial to examine these ideas.
Right. I mean, there, because she came to resent people's interest in phenomena, like the production of miracles.
Yeah. Mm.
Because, I mean, that it was its own means to an end. And I mean, like a lot of her whole personality, I mean, presenting as kind of like the exotic fortune teller look that she had. It was kind of a version of Victorian era branding, you know?
Yeah, completely.
And she kind of, and self-mythologizing. And I mean, she didn't need to make up a lot of her story. I mean, she lived a lot of that. But I mean, she's a grandiose and remarkable figure and a controversial one, which I don't think you can not be under those circumstances.
Yeah.
And it's pretty amazing. What she was able to accomplish for a woman of her time and how she managed to do it. I think it was necessary to be a bit of a trickster. The garnering attention was a big part of that.
Yep.
But sometimes you would have to do something extraordinary to get people to listen. And that's what she would sometimes refer to as like a blind or writing. There would be something a bit misleading, but it was a blind to make you realize there's a hidden truth behind that.
Yeah.
What do you think her main motivation in all this was?
I think she had several. I mean, I think she had an anti-colonialist bent to her for sure. I think a lot of her interest in India and Tibet and being in that area was that she did want those areas preserved the way they were. She preferred them not to be under the thumb of Western control. And I think that was part of it. I don't know how successful she was or if that was her motivation there, but I get the sense that that was part of it. On the esoteric end of things, I mean, she may well have just been earnest in her ideas of trying to, trying to bridge the gap between various esoteric traditions and actually form like a universal brotherhood.
I think that she, I can imagine that she did come across some ideas in her travels, you know, that come from these real sources of Sufism and, you know, Hinduism that we discussed earlier. And I think that she might have been really motivated and, you know, perhaps like spiritually stirred by them. And that there was, you know, a germ of, I guess, like spiritual inspiration in her writing this stuff, even as fiction. You know, I mean, when I get inspired by something as a filmmaker, as an artist, like I express things by kind of taking this and synthesizing it into something else. And, you know, it's possible that that's what she was doing. I think she also was kind of a scenester in a way, you know, as part of the scene. So I think that she did, you know, put together, like AP said, this brand. And it was, you know, how she learned how to kind of like live her life and how she sort of functioned. And it was something that she, a role that I think she probably ended up not convincing herself. Well, yeah, convincing, like she, it was a role that she ended up inhabiting, that she sort of created out of necessity, but also, you know, in the way that everybody, I mean, think of the many people in the paranormal world now that have sort of a, I don't know, a persona like AP Strange or Super Inframan, you know, and I can imagine similar, you know, things going on with her there.
Hey man, I am a master of mystical flapdoodle. So yeah, you have to respect my persona.
Yeah, totally.
But,
flapdoodle.
That's actually a word I cribbed from Blavatsky because I thought it was funny. That's a word that she was using for people that have, you know, just plain crazy ideas.
That's terrific.
It is.
Yeah, from somebody like Blavatsky calling other people crazy.
Right.
One of my friends referred to her as being mad as a bag of cats. And I was like, mad as a bag of cats. That's a great term. And, you know, like, I'm kind of okay with it. Like, I kind of appreciate a lot of things about her that a lot of other people see as, like, a fault. Because
right,
I like grandiose personalities. Like, there's something about that that appeals to me.
I mean, I don't know. If people are going to spend a lot of time thinking about somebody like Crowley, you can spend some time thinking about Blavatsky. It's exactly kind of how I feel.
I feel like Blavatsky has become kind of a punching bag for people or, like, she's just kind of easy, like an easy target, low hanging fruit, where it's just like, oh yeah, Blavatsky. Or like, oh, that idea comes from Theosophy. And there's always kind of like this arrogant brush off of the whole of it. While at the same time, you mentioned Crowley and everybody's like, oh yeah, the dark wizard Crowley. Like,
yeah. And I'm not into hero worship of any of these people. Like, I think you have to have some like really like, I mean, I know that some people, I think that, you know, some people obviously did consider these people to be like, I don't know, masters or their teachers in some way. And sure. But it's, you know, like you can look at this person and sort of examine their place, especially in the history of esotericism. That's one of the things that I think is most important, is to understand the historical context of Blavatsky, her influence on, you know, the current state of sort of esotericism in popular culture and in sort of the, you know, cultural zeitgeist of, you know, at least our culture, Western culture, English speaking culture. Really important.
That's my only hope from this is just that people will do their own investigating and dig around because there's so many fascinating stories there that I think people don't even bother investigating at all. Like Lachman's book is a great place to look for this stuff.
That was what I was just going to ask you, what you would recommend for people to start with.
Like I said, that's where I would probably have them start. But I haven't read that the Key to Theosophy book you were talking about. That might be a good direct source.
Yeah, that's kind of one where you can skip around a bit. Because like I said, it's like a frequently asked questions sort of deal.
That's good.
It's written as a question and answer book. So like the Crib Notes version of Theosophy. So it's that's a good place to start as far as Blavatsky's actual writings go. You're talking about the sort of ego and branding too. It's kind of funny because one of my favorite accounts was from G.R.S. Mead of somebody trying to like prostrate themselves in front of Blavatsky and bow to her like she was some kind of like high guru.
Yeah.
She like shrieked in disgust and like walked away. The hell are you doing? Yeah.
That's great.
It's funny stuff because then I wouldn't want to bag on Crowley. I'm glad Chris brought it up and not me, but like I've never really been a big fan of I've never been that into him. And there's certainly things you can criticize him where that I know of, but I've also not investigated him very thoroughly. And I think at this point I've done a fair amount of reading about Blavatsky and dug into it enough where I feel like I don't know, like I've at least given her a chance and looked into it a bit, you know?
Right. Wow. Yeah. I mean, I've
say some things, but
I've definitely been influenced by Crowley quite a bit. But I also don't take him completely seriously.
Yeah. And I think I don't think people shouldn't not look at Crowley. I just think that there are more, you know, it's like there's more stuff out. Like, I think you should be looking at, Blavatsky. I think people should be looking again at Gurdjieff. I think people should be looking at, Austin Osmond Spare. I think people should be looking at Meher Baba. I think people should be looking at, some of the writers in the late 1800s, like Arthur Machen and, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's all interconnected.
The whole world out there. Occult adjacent people or occult people that are just, it's fascinating to read about.
I started reading the Seth material again recently.
Nice.
I was going to tell you that, but I was going to finish reading it first, Soraya. Interesting. We should talk about it at some point. I'm quite it's been a while since I read it.
Cool. Yeah, I got a book from one of the people who used to go to Jane's classes. It's a short book, Road to Elmira, I think it's called. So I plan on reading through that, but I also downloaded a paper called The Problem with Seth that's apparently a critical look at it. So I want to read through that too and see what that person has to say.
Totally.
So, because I'm not against looking at all sides of this. I mean, after I read Seth the first time, I was like, okay, let me find the rebuttal to this stuff. And I couldn't.
Right.
And that's what threw me. It's like, why is nobody like the only thing I would see is some really fundamental Christians saying, well, Seth was a demon.
Yeah. But that's what they say. It's like everything is a demon.
Right. So I'm like,
Seth is a demon. Harry Potter's a demon.
I'm like, where's the criticism of Seth said this, but then Seth said this, and it was a complete contradiction. And then he said this, which was a complete contradiction. There's none of that. So I want to see what this paper has, because I'm interested to see what this person found problematic about the Seth material.
For sure.
So we are out of time. AP, where can people find you?
You can find me at apstrange.com. I'm on Twitter. That's about it for now.
Okay. And Chris?
You can go to brightrectangle.com or Amazon or Troma Now to find films that I do.
Nice. All right. Thank you both.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
I want to give a shout out here to all of my Patreons, because without you, this show would not be possible. And I want to give a special shout out to those who are pledging $10 or more. Illuminati, Greg Ross, Leanne Cherry, Matt in Delaware, Allison Cook, Super Inframan, Indrid Cold, 36 Dingo, Matthew Sproul, Andrew Nichols, Christine, a blue second gen MR2 drifting around a Japanese mountain, Patricia Gaiaquinta, Alex Whitcomb, American Rambler, Andrew Maines, Ann Witowski, Barbara Fisher, Beverly Williamson, Big Boy Limina, Charles Davis, Charles in Florida, Land of the Crazy and Communicable, Chris, Craig Cisternos, Greg Parmenter, Diane B., MTK, Eric Todd, History and Coffee, J. Otto Bullitt, Jack Huntington, James Lindsay, Jim and Sophie, John Mattingly, John Bracken, Carla Mahoney, Kevin Schreck, Cool Kitty, Kristen L., Laser Printer Jam, Lauren McLean, Linda, Linz Jackson K., Luke Osborne, MJ Armstrong, Mark Brady, Mr. Weird, Oli Andre Olar, Patricia W., Paul Jeffries, Philosopher of Mirrors, Riker and Stark, Ron Dupre, Sam Sharon, Seed Person 1, Stacy Sherwood, Tactical Therapist, Taylor Bell, Thunderboy, Tyler G. Glimstead, Varouche K., Vincent Trewell, Will Gebhard, Will Powell, Ren Collier, Annabelle Smith, Caroline Walker, TDT Skunkworks, and Craig Sagastumi. Thank you all so very, very much. There is a Patreon segment from this show, and next week's show actually will continue, not on Theosophy, but on some interconnected stuff. That is going to be a really interesting show. But I want to get this Theosophy one out there first, because I wanted it to kind of fill out a little bit of where things are going to connect next week. So there you go. There's, like I said, there's a Patreon segment. If you want to become a Patreon, please, $3 a month is all it is, and it helps us out immensely. I want to welcome a new Patreon this week, Mark Bowley. Thank you for joining up, Mark. I hope you like the content. I'll see you next time. You have been listening to Where Did the Road Go? This show is made possible in part from our Patreons, and we thank you and everyone listening for helping us continue this exploration of the strange. You can always find everything Where Did the Road Go related at www.wheredidtheroadgo.com. And thank you so much for your support.